IVM.
ISIS, the Islamic State in Iraq and Syria. Not the Egyptian goddess, but the Middle Eastern nightmare. Kabir Taneja makes a persuasive case for why Indians should care about ISIS and its social media mode of operation in this episode of the Pragati podcast. Welcome to the Pragati podcast, a weekly talk show on public policy, economics, and international relations. I am your host, Pavan Srinath. I'm here in Delhi at Pindrop Studios to record this episode with Kabir Taneja. Kabir is an associate fellow at the Observer Research Foundation, and he works on India's relations with the Middle East and studies terrorism, political dynamics, and the evolution of non-state actors. In August 2018, Kabir published an excellent monograph titled The ISIS Phenomenon, South Asia and Beyond. On the podcast today, we talk about the evolution of ISIS and why Indians must pay attention to the phenomenon that it is. Before that, I have a little announcement. Kannada barutta, swalpa adjust maadkolakke agutta. The Thale-Harate Kannada podcast is the latest show on IVM. My friends Surya, Prakash, Ganesh, Chakravarthi and I have launched a weekly Kannada podcast that bridges the Kannada and English worlds. We talk about Bangalore and Karnataka, and we talk about issues that rarely get spoken about in Kannada. We have episodes coming out every Wednesday, and we are there on all podcast platforms as the Thale-Harate Kannada podcast and on social media as Harate Pod. The link is in the description. Check it out, and banni, Kannadadallu naav Harate hodiyona. I'll be back with Kabir after this short break.
Hello, 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 everybody. Welcome to another great week on IVM Podcast. If you aren't following us on social media, please make sure you do. We're IVM Podcast on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. If you guys want to catch Cyrus's rant on Cyrus's Live, you can definitely check out Instagram. We kind of publish that live every time we're doing it on Tuesday afternoons. Make sure you check in for that. On Cyrus this week, actually, we had a really great guest, Roshan Abbas. Roshan talks about a wonderful career spanning radio, TV, live events, entrepreneurship, and now he's an author, too. It's full of funny stories, and I think you guys will really enjoy it. On Advertising is Dead, Varun is joined by Jio Savan co-founder, president, and chief strategy officer Vinod Bhatt. He gets into details about their latest partnership with Jio, their big plans for the company in the coming year, and a whole lot more. On the 99th episode of The Seen and the Unseen, Amit is joined by lawyer and policy analyst Ameya Naik. They talk about the rules and institutions that keep populist readers in check and how they are being meddled with. Last week on the Pragati podcast, Supreme Court lawyer Ninad Lau joined host Pavan Srinath to talk about PILs, the NGT, and overall environmental governance in India. On the Echoes of India, Anirudh gives us a history of Pompeii Lakshmi, an Indian ivory statuette which was uncovered in the ancient Roman city of Pompeii. On Puliyavade, Pranay speaks to Chinmay Tumbe, a scholar in Indian migration. They talk about the Indian community's prolific migration across the world and the phenomena of a good migrant. And with that, on with your shows.
Hi, Kabir. Welcome to the Pragati podcast.
Thank you so much.
It's also a pleasure to finally meet you. You've been a scholar at the Takshashila Institution in the past, yeah. And we've worked remotely before. But it's a pleasure to finally get you into the studio here in Delhi and talk to you about ISIS.
Yeah.
So, Kabir, I live in Bangalore. Mm-hmm. And yes, there was some stuff that happened with ISIS and Twitter a while ago, which we'll get to. Mm-hmm. But when we look at all the problems in India, even the terrorism problems in India, ISIS seems like a distraction. It seems like something that the Americans and the people in the Middle East have to deal with, while we have the Lashkar-e-Taiba, closer to home.
Yeah.
We have the Taliban who are still, who are resurgent in Afghanistan. And it feels like, why do I care about what's happening with the ISIS?
Yeah.
So why should we care?
So this is the thing, right? We know that our immediate problems are on our borders. Right? And so we are obsessed in a way with what's happening in Pakistan, what's happening in Kashmir, and now on the Eastern Front with China. But that's not a terrorism thing. That's a sovereign thing. But with Pakistan, with cross-border terrorism, Lashkar-e-Taiba, Jaish-e-Mohammed. So we are obsessed with that part of terrorism, which is very hyper-local from a global context, right? So it only concerns predominantly us. So LET is a little active in Afghanistan, but it's not a big concern to anyone, especially even in Afghanistan.
Which is why no one else talks much about LAT too.
Which is why India also has problems, I think, bringing this issue up with the United Nations, because it's that hyper-local, right? I mean, from a global context, right? If it was Al-Qaeda, a resurgent Al-Qaeda in Kashmir, it would be a different discourse in the United Nations.
True.
LAT and, Jaish or Haqqanis, it's a different whole narrative that concerns predominantly this part of the world. So, but the thing is that, I mean, there's a distinction between, as I said, domestic jihad, which is what India faces, and global jihad. So the global jihad thing actually moved from Al-Qaeda to Islamic State. So the whole narrative with that goes towards ISIS, right? And ISIS revels in it. You know, that's, we have to understand this, that we are sort of in a time when you and I are on Twitter, so is ISIS. So they use the same platforms that we do. They suddenly have the same access to the technologies that we have. So what the technologies we use to communicate with our loved ones, you know, on WhatsApp or whatever, thousand other things, they use the same things, right? So how do you sort of put barriers into what we are now calling the most connected time in human race, right? So which is, you know, like, for example, when a lot of people are now aware of how good ISIS was on online, so Twitter, whatever, you know, Facebook or all these things. But how it all started is interesting to sort of understand. So the whole use of Twitter, for example, by jihadist groups, global jihadist groups, so, right, only came after a local jihadist group first used it and tried it out. This was the, I can't remember the year, but the attacks on Westgate Mall in Kenya.
Okay.
Right. So that was the time, first time when Al-Shabaab used Twitter. And they live tweeted the entire sort of event. And that's the first time, I think, even the platforms themselves realized what's happening, along with law enforcement, intelligence, everyone. And it took, at that point of time, Twitter, almost the entire course of the operation to kill these people in inside the mall to delete that account. So they had done their job.
Amazing.
By that time. Right?
So this is completely different from what we were thinking about as terrorism 20 years ago, 15 years ago.
Because jihad is not new, right? But the times have changed. So the platforms of, I mean, committing terrorism have now also gone digital. Right. So you don't need to actually physically go and blow up something, right? Like, I'll give you an example of how this convergence sort of between global jihadist movements and hyper-local situations in Kashmir, for example. There was this case couple of months back, 2-3 months back, about what I call in my own lexicon, you know, freelance jihadists. That just, you know, where the wind is going or where the money is or where the weapons are, whatever. Whatever they are looking for. And they just go into that direction, right? This guy who went into a suburb of Srinagar in Kashmir, you know, shot at a cop. The cop died. He escaped and he went to internet cafe. Right. We don't have them anymore.
Yeah, a cyber cafe.
Cyber cafe, right. So he went to a cyber cafe and he emailed Amak News Agency. Now, Amak News Agency is a quasi-official outlet of ISIS, right? They exist on various platforms like, they used to be on Twitter, Facebook now, but Telegram is one. And a lot of platforms that are coded. So, there's no back entrance to it. The law enforcement doesn't have access to it.
And it's a whack-a-mole, right? So you ban them from one platform.
I'll tell you how this all sort of got built up so much. So this guy shot the cop, emailed Amak News Agency. Now, this is 2018, right? So like we know, the Islamic State, the so-called Islamic State, was formed in June 2014 when Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi at the Al-Nuri Mosque in Mosul went to the mosque and declared that this is a caliphate now. You know, I'm the caliph, this is the caliphate. And after that, they did take over a lot of territory, right? And we'll get to that also, why that happened. So technically, the rise of ISIS was in a landmass which is very far from India, right? Which has happened before also. It's not new. It's happening right now also with Boko Haram in Mali. Just that it's Africa, so no one gives a shit. it doesn't matter. So from a global sort of context, they're like, Africa is fine. We'll deal with it later on. But because it was happening in Iraq and Syria, specifically after the Arab Spring. So there was a lot of, you know, because Arab Spring was seen as a positive change happening in the Middle East, right? Which was one of the largest mistakes of narrative that I've seen in a long time. And it was also pushed by the Obama administration, you know, at that point. So this guy emailed Amak News Agency that I've killed this cop for you, Right. No one asked him to do it. He was not in touch with any handlers. He was not in touch with, from what we know till now, with, you know, any of the senior sort of hierarchies of ISIS in Iraq or Syria. And Amak News, and this is, of course, as I said, 2018, right? So because of the Russian military intervention and the American-led military intervention, ISIS lost its territory. They are concentrated in a very small desert area in Syria now. But, you know, they were like maybe 80, 90,000 strong at their peak in 2015. No one knows where they went. You just know that the territory that they held is not there anymore, which was inevitable. As right. soon as someone was coming in to fight them, like the Russians or the Americans, that was going to happen. So we knew that they cannot hold territory, right?
So there's this person in Srinagar who's done this,
huh.
who says that he's killed a cop so in the name of ISIS.
Yeah. So he emails Amak saying, I've done this in your name. Within a couple of hours, Amak releases a statement saying, you know, ISIS Mujahideen kills cop in Srinagar.
Wow.
Right. So Amak doesn't know who he is. But they released a statement, and that, you know, Amak's, because Amak uses Telegram or whatever it is, you know, all these systems, you know, everyone from the New York Times to the Hindustan Times to a journalist sitting in Fiji has access to these sort of releases. And what happens to these releases? They automatically make it to the headline, right? So this guy became ISIS within a 5-hour period without having any contact with them. And the narrative then started, ISIS has appeared in Kashmir. Well, that narrative was there before also. But the whole, you know, you must have seen this ISIS JNK and all these kind of things.
Yeah, and anyone can fly an ISIS flag, right?
Which is also what happened in Kashmir. Like, I'll very quickly, since you brought that up, one of the first instances of the pictures that came out of the stone pelting cases in Kashmir in 2016, 2017, were cases of ISIS flags being flown and all that kind of stuff. At least in one of the cases, the guy who was doing that was actually from Bangladesh. Right.
Okay.
So he got in touch with another ISIS sympathizer in Calcutta through, I think it was Facebook, but I'm not sure. But one of these platforms. And they were talking about what can be done. And the guys have had access to some money also, especially the Bangladeshi guy. So he told this guy from Calcutta, I'm giving you some money. You go and do a recce. So he went to Delhi. He went to, from Delhi, he went to Kashmir. And in Kashmir, he, during the stone pelting, waved the ISIS flag. This is just one person having access to, let's say, 20,000 rupees doing this, right? And he waved the flag and all that. And the pictures came up everywhere.
And the pictures are terrifying and they cause
right.
a big narrative.
Right.
But, I mean, this is fascinating what you're telling me. This is like a Manchester United fan in Bangladesh getting together with a Manchester United fan in India and then waving a jersey in Kashmir, right?
Yeah.
And it's no different.
No, it's no different. It's the same thing.
And I mean, we don't make news out of, oh my God, there are Manchester United fans in Kashmir. There are many and there should be.
Exactly.
But if it's ISIS, then it's terrifying.
No, of course, because especially that flag has become synonymous with fear now. Right.
Yes.
For example, the first time ISIS flag was waved in Kashmir, the flag was actually wrong. It belonged to an Al-Qaeda affiliate in, very small Al-Qaeda affiliate in Iraq.
Right.
Right. But even the guy who was flying it thought it's an ISIS flag because there is no, right. Because if you see what's written on the ISIS flag, it's very specific sort of like imagery and you know what it says. Because let's remember, every jihadist movement is based on a theological argument. But this theological argument doesn't mean that it's going to sell to everyone or you need it to sell it to everyone.
Right.
Most of the people with ISIS who got attracted to it, and let's also make one thing clear here, that a lot of them were middle class, educated. So that whole narrative of didn't have any prospects, you know, so got wavered into this and all is sort of
some of these
false.
Are being debunked. So this is amazing. So let's take a bunch of steps back. My colleague Narayan Ramachandran has a very interesting phase. And he said that what was interesting about ISIS was that they were the first terrorist outfit to capture GDP.
Yeah.
And in that sense, they were also very different from the Taliban. I mean, the Taliban still ran a state, a horrendous one.
Yeah,
But was still a little different. So from Al-Qaeda and the mental image we have is, of course, very skewed and flawed. But the idea is that there are these terrorists hiding out in the mountains of Afghanistan and Pakistan who are you know, hiding in caves, who are waging war, who have some access and some supplies and networks for guns and ammunition, but by and large, they're on the fringe, right? Geographical, societal, and otherwise. Mm. And cut to what happens in ISIS and what happens in Syria and in Iraq, where you have terrorists who start running cities and who start getting access to oil fields.
Right?
So tell us a little bit about that journey. I mean, you talked about Baghdadi declaring that the caliphate has been formed. But tell us a little about that journey and what's happened over there since then.
Right. So, see, I mean, let's remember that ISIS came from Al-Qaeda. It didn't appear out of, you know, out of the blue moon. So Al-Qaeda in Iraq was an entity. I can't remember the year, but there was Zarqawi was the guy who was the sort of, you know, chief of Al-Qaeda in Iraq. And he only became chief. He used to be a petty criminal, basically, in Iraq. But he only became chief or got that sort of leverage after his name randomly came into a Colin Powell speech in 2006 or 7.
Wow. Right?
Because at that time, Colin Powell, in his one of his statements that he made at the UN or something else, I can't remember, said that Zarqawi is the chief of Al-Qaeda in Iraq and he's the most dangerous man in Iraq. And this is what we are targeting. Zarqawi was no one at that point of time.
So he became the most dangerous man because he was called the most dangerous man.
He was called the most dangerous man, right?
That's
so
amazing.
That became a big sort of, for him, he was just elevated through all the ranks that were there in Iraq. Because suddenly the Americans were going after him exclusively. While Zarqawi didn't even know that he was on the radar of the Americans. But he used that leverage to build an ecosystem. And I'll tell you why Zarqawi is important. Because Zarqawi started off as a sort of petty criminal in Jordan. So he's a Jordanian, or was a Jordanian guy. He's dead now. But when he was, you know, trying to build his ecosystem, he was as bad as any other jihadi trying to make his sort of way, right? One of his first, I think, attacks that he planned was in a movie theater somewhere, either Jordan or Iraq, I can't remember. But that movie theater was apparently playing pornographic films, and that was against his beliefs. So he decided we needed to put a stop to this because it's westernization and it's an American influence coming in. So he got one of his people to strap a bomb and, you know, walk into the theater. This guy went into the theater. The movie was playing. He got very distracted with it, started watching it. And the bomb blew off. It ripped apart his leg and all that kind of stuff, right? So you can see the very sort of nascent stages from where he began to what ISIS is now.
And these are idiots with guns and bombs.
Idiots with guns and bombs, right? But of course, Zarqawi was not just an idiot, clearly, because he managed to sort of rally the ecosystem. And most of his sort of building up capital was in prisons, as it usually happens, right? But Zarqawi was also the guy who, after being made famous by Colin Powell, he also thought that as part of Al-Qaeda, Al-Qaeda was not strong enough in taking the Americans in the Middle East and kicking them out.
Right.
So he saw Osama bin Laden as sort of going soft in his target. So Osama bin Laden, you know, had met Zarqawi in Afghanistan. Zarqawi had training camps in Afghanistan as part of Al-Qaeda. But he did not see eye to eye with bin Laden a lot. But bin Laden needed him to set up a sort of Yemen-like constituency in Iraq.
So like an affiliate group.
Pretty much, yeah. But, you know, Zarqawi would go up to bin Laden and say, you're only limiting us by saying only target the Americans or the Israelis. We need to think larger. We need to think, you know, we need to take over the Middle East. He was from that sort of spectrum. And bin Laden never, of course, was being challenged and he didn't like that.
Right. And Al-Qaeda also, I mean, their talks might have been about many things, but they were always a terrorist outfit, right?
So of course, yeah. They were always a terror outfit, but Al-Qaeda was very sort of regimented.
Hmm.
Right. It was very hierarchical. It was very regimented. But the success of Al-Qaeda sort of existed in the fact that their commanders had a lot of democracy.
Okay.
So they would take ideas to bin Laden. Bin Laden was just used to sign them off. Operationally, he gave them a lot of freedom to do what they want. So like the 9/11 attacks, it's not that, you know, bin Laden sat down and drew up the maps. They came up to him saying, this is what we think we are planning. And he said, go ahead. Right. So he became the face of Al-Qaeda, of course. But he gave a lot of freedom to his commanders, which is why there was very little sort of defection within Al-Qaeda. So there were, the loyalty was a lot there because people had freedom. So the commander also needed to feel powerful. Right. So the same sort of systems also existed in ISIS, which is you're talking about setting up a quasi-government, you know, taxing people or setting up systems. It's because they allowed, you know, democracy of jihad, basically. Right. They allowed people to...
So it's almost like federated jihad.
Pretty
right?
much.
So,
yeah,
so
yeah,
you allow...
Yeah.
Your local goons some autonomy.
Exactly.
And by giving them autonomy, you can grow bigger.
Bigger, yeah. As long as your religious arguments on what you're doing and why you're doing are very, very strong. So if you start wavering around those, then any sort of such movement in the Middle East or anywhere else will start wavering.
But tell me about that, right? I mean, there's one about, you can go into deep into Islamist philosophy and so on. But these are fairly crude ideas of even around Islam and how religion plays a role, right? So it's like, you destroy idols. Mm. You know, whatever is considered haram under a very narrow definition, outlaw that, punish people very, very severely for that.
Yeah.
The religious aspect, was that crude, right?
It was crude, right? But it's always been crude in that sense. Even under Al-Qaeda in the late 90s, early 2000s. The thing that changed here is, of course, that us sitting in India, for example, or anyone sitting in remote part of Canada or whatever it is, had access to see what they were doing if people did not follow their diktats, right? The whole, for example, you remember they burnt alive a Jordanian pilot that they had captured when his plane had crashed.
Right.
And they made a spectacle out of it. When the video was released, he was burnt alive in a cage. You can see that it's like theater with people standing, flags, and, you know, well-produced production.
This was so much worse than... I mean, you would have those horrible, grotesque, but grainy images coming from some cave in Afghanistan.
Yeah, I mean, not even Afghanistan. If you see what happened in Iraqi prisons after the 2003 invasion, right? We will see pictures coming in sort of leaked out or grainy in the dark cell and all that, which is what was the norm, right?
So, but now it is live. It is produced.
Yeah.
So terrorism that has production value.
Production value. And like, I know scholars who have tried to like answer very simple questions around this. How do you upload a 4K video file of 13 minutes, which is 2 GB in size, and upload it from Aleppo, which is bombed out?
Wow.
How do you do it?
And somebody figured it out.
And somebody figured it out. But us as scholars, I remember sitting with a person who runs a tech company. And we sat down for one whole day trying to figure this out. We saw the various systems and, you know, it's possible. It's not like not it's possible. But it's only possible when you have good amount of money with you. Right? And let's remember...
And talent.
And talent, of course. But we know that, right? Like, ISIS also had a small team only dedicated to crew drones. Right? So there was one Tunisian engineer and one engineer of French descent, I think, Algerian French descent. They were tasked with building drones. And they did.
Oh, wow.
So we have videos of ISIS drones dropping crude pipe bombs and stuff on tanks and cars and stuff like that. So they did that also.
So this is like the internet age meets sort of weird startup culture meets horrendous violence.
Pretty much. You know, there was...
So we have to keep our eyes open, right?
That's the thing, right? So like, even if you, like, there's in the middle, of course, and I think rightly so, people were very angry with Twitter and Facebook that you're not doing enough to counter this thing. Now see, but I totally agree with that. They were not doing enough at that point of time. I think they've gotten better now. But even when this all started, I think it even caught the sort of platforms by surprise. Of course, there is always tendency of bad, malicious content there, right? But to weaponize Facebook or to weaponize Twitter, it was something that they didn't envisage this is going to happen.
And we talk about weaponizing Facebook and Twitter from the view of political parties. And this is at another level.
No, this is at a whole different level, right? But even Facebook and Twitter, to counter this, they need experts. Now, experts like this don't grow on trees. You know, it's not like hiring for Wipro or Infosys. No diss to Wipro or Infosys. But it's not like hiring engineers or something. You need people who understand. Just removing content doesn't work, but they understand how it is being used, from what perspective it is being used, and how to counter it from not just a technological side, but from a thought side.
Right. This is not a reactionary, okay, I'll take this offensive content down or this horrendous content down.
It's, as you said, you know, earlier, if you take it down there, it'll come up there. How are you going to manage it? Like, I'll give you an example of when the sort of these lone wolf attacks, so-called, were happening in Europe in 2016, 2017. You know, a lot of people were like, why are you allowing Facebook to be used for this kind of stuff and all that? And actually, it was not Facebook, right? So they may see someone showing some sort of inclination or argument towards ISIS on Facebook, but then they take the conversation away to smaller, unheard of chat apps that very few people maybe use, but they still exist. There's something called Vicker, I think. I'm not even sure what it is. Wow. But in one of the cases in Germany, they found out this person had inclinations towards ISIS because he had posted some pictures with the ISIS flag or something. But they contacted him and gave him all the advice using a app that I didn't even know existed. But they use these apps because the purview of the, you know, law enforcement online specifically is limited. Like, right.
And it's so easy to now just build yet another messenger, right?
Yeah, exactly.
That is end-to-end encrypted. Yeah. That, so even if you start working with WhatsApp to sort of figure out how to monitor or
like,
do something.
Why did Telegram become such a big thing? Telegram became popular because of ISIS. No one knew Telegram before ISIS started using it as one of their main systems, right? So all these famous journalists in the world who are following ISIS would be on pro-ISIS Telegram channels, and that's where you got your content from. And ISIS people knew that, you know, a journalist is in this chat room with us. And they were fine with it because they knew that if the argument or their side needs to go out on the front page of the New York Times, Rukmini Kalemaki needs to be part of us. And we need to be feeding the person all the output that we're doing. BBC interviewed this Italian journalist 2 months ago who was in captivity in Syria for a couple of months, right? And this is part of the ISIS economy, right? Extortion, basically. So a lot of people would pay money. Governments have paid money. There was a report in the United Nations also that got amended because I think they put it online erroneously of how much money the countries have paid ISIS just to get citizens out, like tens of millions of dollars. Right. So they know how to gather money. But, you know, but that's the thing. Like even something like Telegram is a Russian service. Right. So it's owned by a Russian entrepreneur, basically. Now, the problem here they faced is that they cannot turn Telegram down because it's also the most popular app used by Russian politicians.
Wow.
For normal use, right? For not, right. But just because they didn't want to use WhatsApp, which is an American thing, thinking that they may, you know, the intelligence may get a backdoor entry. You never know what happens. We are going to use something where the servers are in Russia. So it was as popular with the Russian politicians for normal work as it was for ISIS to dispense information. So what do you do? What does Telegram do? So they can say at best, what we will do is we will try to clean it up.
Right.
That's not easy.
And if you start doing bans, then you start hurting innocent people.
Yeah,
if you say
absolutely.
That from this geographic area, I will not allow anyone to access this.
No, but like, what we are discussing, despite that, a lot of information that we got through Telegram, through these things, were also critical in getting a lot of stories out, you know, of the kind of suffering that's happening in Syria or
Iraq. So both the sort of the victims and the perpetrators and the villains are all used on the same platforms.
Coming back to the point that it's the same platforms.
Mm.
They're not using anything that's plucked from the stars or something like that, that we can say, oh, what's happening? They're using the same tech that we use now. Like, Al-Qaeda has been doing what ISIS has been doing for a long time. But Al-Qaeda came up mostly through the 90s. So the way to...
pre-social media and the post-social media.
Yeah, absolutely. And the way to make a mark in pre-social media was, okay, let's attack a U.S. Navy destroyer, the coal incident that happened. Yes, attack the American embassy in Tanzania or whatever it is, right? Very elaborate sort of... operations. You don't need that kind of elaboration anymore. ISIS is doesn't hold much geography today, but their output hasn't gone down. It's still the same. It did go down in the middle, then it comes up, then it goes down, then it comes up. So, and that's not necessarily has a lot to do with, you know, air raids against them or stuff like that. That's their own sort of how they want the information to go out. So, you know, it's a lot has changed. So, And we are only catching up now. So we, like, for example, India doesn't have good enough capacity for monitoring cyber issues. A lot of pro-ISIS cases that we have, Shami witnessed, for example, in Bangalore. How did that arrest happen? We didn't know he was sitting there. For I used to follow him on Twitter for 7 months.
Wow.
Right.
But the government of India was not.
No. Ultimately, cognizant. What happened was the British intelligence was looking for this Shami Witness fellow. And they found out, okay, maybe it's a person of South Asian origin living in a suburb near London. So that's what they were going for. During their investigations and all, they realized, oh, he's not in England altogether. He's in Bangalore. What do you do? They were like, look, just leak the information out. So Channel 4 got hold of it, however it was. They made a documentary on who Shami Witness was. This guy, I think Mehdi Biswas or whatever his name was, sitting in Bangalore working for a MNC. And, you know, in the day he has a day job, and at night he's Shami Witness. And it was only then his arrest happened. The Indian intelligence apparatus had no idea. And they still didn't. A lot of people who have been flagged for ISIS activities between 2015 and 2017, I think 80% of the cases are flagged by foreign intelligence agencies.
Wow.
Because it's all about capacity, right? You have to build capacity. The NSA has capacity. The GCHQ has capacity. It's just that we haven't realized that capacity needs to be built because which is quite ironic considering we are supposed to be the IT superpower or something like that.
We'll be back with Kabir Taneja after this short break.
How aware do you think you are of your laws and rights? Do you look up to laws when you are caught up in situations? Do you know what your rights are when you're stuck somewhere bad? Well, here's a show that can help you move an inch closer to being aware of what your rights are. Tune into Know Your Kanoon with me, Amber Rana. This is a podcast meant to answer all your law-related queries. Catch Know Your Kanoon every week on the IVM website or the app or anywhere you get your podcast from.
Welcome back.
Kabir, we've talked a lot about how ISIS operates online.
Yeah.
What's been happening on the ground? All the violence happens in the real world, yeah. Right? And yeah. they use social media very strategically.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, we constantly hear, at least from the Americans, that ISIS has been defeated. Even in the maps, we see that the territory that they're controlling has radically shrunk.
Mm-hmm.
Is the ISIS in the way we knew it gone? What's happened to it?
So I think ISIS, the way we knew it, in the sense that, you know, they had declared Aleppo as a capital and they had Mosul as one of the major cities where they had taken over completely. I think that's ended for now, right? You cannot predict what happens in the Middle East in the future because it's very volatile in that way. But even when they started doing this, you know, controlling territory, which was larger at a point of time in 2015-16, more than the territory of what Great Britain is. I think most analysts knew at least that this will be a very sort of short-term thing because they don't have the same firepower as the Americans or the Russians or the Iranians, you know, who have all entered the theater, you know, from different perspectives. But I think ISIS at that point of time was this magnet in the middle where everyone was like, let's put our differences aside. Get rid of this first. And then we'll figure out what to do. What to do in the sense of...
How course, to between, split the pie, what, how to yeah, do everything.
Whatever. How will the future look? We'll figure. Let's get rid of this first. And that's why, you know, we saw a lot of friction between the Russians and the Americans, but they were targeting the same targets, right? So the territorial hold of ISIS is now very small compared to what it was. I think they are only concentrated in one desert region called Deir ez-Zor. Very interesting. I'll put a very quick anecdote here. It's also the region where India had large investments in an oil field, along with China, which got overrun by ISIS and we had to abandon everything there. So this was, I think, 2013. So just after the...
Oh, this is ONGC Videsh and others buying stake in a local oil field.
Yeah. So, you know, so but the thing is that despite losing territory, it's like despite the collapse of the caliphate itself territorially, we still don't know much about what happened to the fighters.
And we're talking about what kind of numbers.
So in my sort of understanding, is 60,000 plus.
Okay.
Right. The plus could be anything. Plus could be also 60,005. So, you know.
But you're putting 60 as 60 a base. 60 is, I think, after deaths and everything.
Yeah. After deaths and everything.
And what's the level of... So if you're talking about 60,000 fighters, are they just... people with guns, are they trained in battle?
So I think there's a lot of disparity in that. So some of them are trained, some of them are commander level, you have to remember that a lot of people who joined ISIS after the caliphate was announced were former army members, trained army members of the Saddam Hussein time, right? Yeah. Sunnis.
And that was a very professional army with a lot of history. A
lot of history and a lot of combat experience. You have to remember that. So a lot of the first ISIS appointed governors of Tikrit and Mosul were former Ba'athist generals.
Wow.
So they were from the Saddam army side. So
these are people who know how to conduct warfare. Yeah.
So for example, when there was a story some time back, a very prominent story that 39 Indian construction workers were missing in Iraq. One of the first points of contact for us were the governors of Tikrit and Mosul, because India had good relations with the Saddam regime. So they knew these generals from that time.
Wow.
And some of these fighters are probably also, India helped train them during the 90s. Right. So the first point of contact were these generals, despite them being in ISIS. But they knew India they're fine. So we can help them out or whatever it is.
So we don't know. There will be some generals. There are about 60,000 people.
Not many though. Right. A lot of them are just people who are either caught up in the thing. So they join ISIS just to survive.
Right.
If they don't, if they say, no, I'm not going to join ISIS, they will be shot dead or their family will be killed and all. So a lot of people are actually just that. Which is why when the whole argument of defeat comes into play, there's also a presumption that a lot of these people will be able to just stop because they don't want to be there.
Right.
They're not theologically that driven.
Right.
Right. But, hundreds or thousands could also be just theologically driven. So it's very difficult to sort of
right. And some, I mean, if you're in the trade of war for long enough, then that's what you know how to do. So you will absolutely find another job doing the
so
same thing.
It's a career.
So it's a combination of all of those.
Yeah. So if ISIS was paying them well, which it was at a point of time when it had access to a lot of money, people did not have any reason to sort of go elsewhere. So they were getting money, they were getting power, they were getting whatever they wanted. So it was according to sort of, and again, coming back to this, this was not necessarily they were all theologically on the same side.
Right.
Some of them were just there for the violence.
Right. So we have this 60,000 plus people, some ideologically driven, some who might be mercenaries now, some who are happy to put down arms if they can.
Mm.
And they're being, one, driven out of the territory that they were holding.
Yeah.
So where are they headed?
I think that's one of the academic questions, at least, that people are trying to figure out now. There is no sort of, agreed upon opinion on this yet.
But what are the possibilities?
So the possibilities are, from what we have seen, we have witnessed a lot of deals being cut, which gives free passage, safety passage to ISIS fighters, to basically just move away from territories for now into other territories, and then maybe help them lay down arms or come to a truce or whatever it is, for whatever concessions, intelligence, whatever. One of the big reasons why people say Russia joined into the fray, of course, is to protect its influence zones in the Mediterranean. That's the premier reason. The second is, of course, a lot of senior people from Central Asia, so Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, also joined ISIS. So they moved into Syria. And the natural progression when ISIS collapsed was to move back.
So there's a fear of return.
Yeah.
This is the European fear as well.
This is the same fear. But the fear in Central Asia is a bit more stronger, because the crackdown against radical Islam there is very heavy-handed. Right. Mm-hmm. So they would, in Tajikistan, they would go shut down mosques or whatever it is. So the sort of resentment factor in Central Asia is much higher than, let's say, in Europe, for example.
And territorially, it's more connected. The borders are perhaps a little more fluid.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like the few sort of movements that we know of, they were able to also cross Iran relatively easily, undetected. So it is possible, you can patrol your borders as much as you want. If there is a means of getting through, and corruption plays a big part here.
Absolutely.
You pay the guard on the border and you're like, fine, just move ahead.
So Central Asia, then if there are people who are looking for another theater of conflict, then is Afghanistan a natural place?
Afghanistan, as far as the natural progression, as you said, does factor in very highly. We've all witnessed the rise of the Islamic State, Khorasan, for example, the ISKP, which has come into play in Afghanistan.
So Khorasan is sort of greater Iran. That's an old
Yeah, it's an old
term for that entire
area. So when ISIS was starting up in 2011, 12, 13, that time, before the Islamic State was announced, their media outlets used to release maps of the kind of territory they're aiming for 2020 or whatever it is. And the sort of Kashmir, Pakistan, Afghanistan area was always highlighted as Khorasan. So that saw their sort of...
Oh, so Kashmir is a part of this Khorasan.
Yeah. So, well, in their heads at least.
Yes.
So, but of course, Afghanistan offers you an already existing, melting state, a state in flux, basically. You know, Americans have been there for 17 years. No one knows how to solve the situation. It's easier and it's more natural for a counter jihadist force or one of these people who are returning from Syria to find safety in Afghanistan, right?
Right.
Like, for example, ISIS Khorasan is now a very successful entity in a very short period of time.
In any particular parts of Afghanistan?
So they started from the northern parts, Nangarhar province and all that, because Taliban is more south-centric.
Right. And like you said, there were a lot more people who were from the Central Asian Republics, right? So there might be people of Tajik or Uzbek or
so the
Kyrgyz.
The initial top commanders of ISKP were all Central Asians.
Which is, again, very troubling, right?
Which is very troubling, but...
Because the big anti-Taliban force was in part Pashto, but also heavily Tajik
so
on.
Exactly. So I think
I
remember...
So it's being outflanked, sort of geographically, literally, ethnically.
But even these guys, the Central Asians, Afghanistan is already a very Taliban-centric thing. So it's never easy to create an ecosystem within an ecosystem. The bigger ecosystem will always try to trample you down. So, but... They were able to sort of, with the help of funds, they were able to get some of these dissident Taliban commanders who were not happy with how the things were going, who were not happy with the possibility of some sort of agreement with Kabul and the US for mainstreaming into political discourse of the Taliban.
Right. Oh, we see this all the time, right? Some members of the Taliban are willing to enter negotiations.
And I think that's natural to any such group. You'll always find someone or the other who's ready to dissent. And, a lot of these people, as we discussed earlier, if you pay them $50 extra, they'll just go. Right? Mm-hmm. The fighters specifically. Because they're in it for the money. There's no other job that they know how to do. So this is what they do. But as far as ISKP goes, it's also that the fact that it's been in a very short period of time able to attack targets, for example, in Kabul, which is the capital, right? So the Americans are there, the Afghan army is there, but still in a very short period of time, ISKP has managed to start doing this. And that raises a lot of questions to people. Again, the two, three things that factor in are such sort of rapid, progression of any group means there has to be some state involved. Or there has to be some very strong financial backing involved. Second is, of course, that, they've managed to get some very prominent Taliban members or former Taliban members into the fray who know the ecosystem. So if you want to attack targets in Kabul, how do you go about it? They know that. And the third is, of course, funds. So there has to be someone funding something for you to actually conduct these things. As far as ISKP goes, from what I've learned till now, it's a very new phenomenon. But, they managed to tap into the Haqqanis.
Yeah.
Right? So they use the Haqqani ecosystem. And that ecosystem is very relevant.
Pakistan and ISI sort of funding the Haqqani network and then Haqqani network
according to some of the works that are available out there, which is very limited, but Pakistan and ISI and Haqqanis were the first ones to manage to create a division in ISKP by funding one of the commanders. And the other commander said, look, if you're going to take money from the Pakistanis, that is against the Islamic State's narrative. Right. You cannot take money from these states. They are against us. Right. Our whole mandate is to take over these states.
Huh. Not that all the current notional Islamic states are not Islamic enough.
Exactly. Exactly. And so you colluding with them is sort of against us. So, Haqqanis and ISI managed to create this division within ISKP. So ISKP itself is divided.
Just like Taliban itself has been divided for a very long time.
Exactly. So it's the same thing unfolding under a different t-shirt, basically. You know, you're wearing a different brand now. The outcome is the same in Afghanistan, which is not good for countries like India, because traditionally we see...
And not good for any local Afghans who want peace and prosperity.
But it's good for Pakistan.
Lots of things are unfortunately good for Pakistan.
So like from India, because we see Afghanistan, according to me or my interpretations, as probably our only proper strategic outreach outside our borders. This, we think that this is where our influence really works. And I'm not particularly sure that's true or not, because we rely a lot on soft power and goodwill. In Afghanistan, we build dams, we build schools, parliaments, you know, promote democracy, stuff like that. And unless you have a hard power backing behind it, sort of doesn't work, because we have always leashed on to other people's policies in Afghanistan. It was the Soviets earlier, now we are leashing on to the Americans. So our big fear is larger ISKP present if the Americans tomorrow, or President Trump, as erratic as he is, you know, suddenly tweets out that I'm withdrawing every troop that we have. Then what are you going to do? You don't have an ecosystem. That's where, you know, Pakistan, using both its leverages from the Taliban and ISKP, can build its entire ecosystem, and you'll be left high and dry.
And finally, this, I mean, it's not just how much India cares about Afghan people and the current Islamic Republic of Afghanistan, but also what can happen thereafter.
Absolutely.
Right? And what can happen back home for
Absolutely.
Us.
Absolutely. I mean, you must have noticed recently, because there are a lot of multilateral systems happening for peace in Afghanistan right now.
Yeah. There's something happening in Russia, something happening elsewhere.
Right. Recently, I think it was in Almaty, I'm not sure. But we did send an unofficial delegation to sit on the same table as the Taliban. Right. And a lot of this comes from the fact that if we officially engage with the Taliban and say, okay, fine, you can be part of the political system, or ISKP's members can be part of the political system, what argument do you have in Kashmir then?
Right. And what does it do for legitimacy? I mean, like you mentioned,
absolutely,
Powell and one speech naming one man helped him become the caliph, the notional caliph of the Islamic State.
Or at least pushed him in that direction.
Yeah, pushed him in that direction. So this, who do you recognize? Who do you even talk to?
Absolutely.
Who do you talk to officially, unofficially, secretly, not secretly?
Absolutely.
All has gigantic implications.
You know, that's the thing with these groups. Like, for example, it was that easy. Just the fact that some money flew in ISKP, that one of the commanders said, let's leave the larger ISIS sort of thinking behind. We're getting money here, we'll do our own thing. That easy. So it's not, creating barriers within this wasn't that hard. It was hard in Syria and Iraq.
Right.
Because there they were managing it in the middle, being with them. So it wasn't, if you were going to desert Baghdadi's diktats for $5 million, you're gone.
Mm-hmm.
But this is different now. Right. The commanders are handling their own thing. Which comes back to what the point I made earlier, that this is what Bin Laden used to do. This sort of democratic use of his force, or allowing them free hand, which Zarqawi doesn't allow.
Right.
Right. Because they already had a friction between these two ideologies.
So in the end now, I mean, I'm, you know, the challenge always with whenever we talk about terrorism is how much do you terrorize our own minds and our intellects while discussing terrorism. So one, to me, the takeaway is it goes back to what Mad-Eye Moody says in Harry Potter, right? Constant vigilance.
Yeah.
So it seems like a no-nonsense answer whenever we're talking about any of this.
Yeah.
And apart from this no-nonsense idea, it's also about very much thinking about, don't just look at South Asia, don't just look at India, don't just look at Lashkar-e-Taiba and whatever, but this is terrorism and a violent conflict in the age of the internet, and specifically in the age of social media.
Yeah.
And this can have gigantic implications for us back home.
Absolutely. But also, it's not just about back home. I think there is still, specifically in the academic discourse, there is still a lot of debate on how much social media really figures in here. Because even to drive someone to commit an act through social media, that part of radicalization on basis of theology needs to exist first, and then this is a sort of medium towards it.
Right. It's an accelerator.
It's a massive accelerator. That's the thing. But you need to sell jihad as a commodity first. then you go to these people and say, do this for us or do that for us. Because that loyalty factor needs to be built first. And even in doing that, the internet played a big part for ISIS. They released materials during 2013-14, after the Arab Spring and during the Arab Spring, in multiple languages. So did Al-Qaeda. Just that the Al-Qaeda one didn't stick.
Right.
But ISIS knew, because of getting help from all these people who were educated and had sort of joined the quote-unquote movement, they knew how to work the current state of systems. Right? They knew the potentials of the internet. They knew the potentials of communications. And they knew the potentials of using these tools to get through Western societies and target those areas that have been either ghettoized or where Muslims are feeling not assimilated or
disenfranchised.
Yeah, disenfranchised, whatever. Ways. Right. Even if, but that's the thing, even if one person does a knife attack in Munich, right, injuring someone, that's news. That's massive news. That the whole sort of political ecosystem in Hungary coming up, in Austria coming up, is has like, you know, tentacles from this only. The fear is emitting from these incidents only. These are comparatively not even massive incidents to what happens in the Middle East.
Right. And so this is definitely not a time for complacence for us.
No, absolutely not. Yeah. But that's for one of the things that I'm working on now for the book that is going to come out later on, is the fact that getting too involved with our, you know, perspective of terror just from the issues of Pakistan and Kashmir is a very bad place to be in. You are going to miss out on global jihadi trends that are coming up at a very fast pace, and your ecosystems will not develop at the same pace. So you'll have massive gaps that the same terror groups that you've been fighting for 60 years in Kashmir right now and you're over-obsessed with will manage to tap into these ecosystems, these new ecosystems where you haven't been able to plug gaps. Internet is one of the major ones. We are still so deficient in this area. It's to me, it's borderline worrying because there is no sense of urgency to it. I've talked to cops who have worked in Kashmir, for example, on not even countering terror online, countering narratives online. And they're like, yeah, there are two people sitting there doing something on Facebook.
Wow.
Right. So compare a GCHQ type of institution that has built up very quickly because they recognized the threats of right. How the threats are moving to us who are still very overly reliant on human intelligence still. Right. So again, most of these ISIS things, even on Facebook that got flagged in West Bengal, in Hyderabad, were done by foreign intelligence agencies that work closely with the Indian. But our own ecosystem shows no urgency right now to plug in these gaps, which I think is fairly worrying.
On that worrying note, Kabir, definitely food for thought. I mean, we need basic law and order. Yeah. We need law and order again in the age of the internet.
Yeah.
Right? And I mean, we see a few shoots here and there. Mm. I'm coming from Bangalore, where there was one progressive police chief who took to Twitter and said that now, so I remember, you know, there was a bomb blast on Church Street, an IED that exploded and one person unfortunately passed away a few years ago. Within 30 minutes of this, it happened on a street called Church Street that became, there were handles, I think, out of Pakistan and elsewhere who started talking about this became a blast at a church and end violence against minorities in India.
Yeah,
and all this, that within 20 minutes.
Yeah. Exactly. Do you see the pace for it?
Right. And thankfully, we had a Bangalore police CPBLR, which was on Twitter already, should establish some credibility, which could go out there and say, calm down.
Yeah.
Yes, this is a bad thing that happened, a very horrible thing that has happened, but it's one IED. It's not anything worse. This is not a pattern. The street happens to be called Church Street and we are on it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so like you said, I mean, we need to be doing that at 100 times that scale on various things.
Absolutely.
Instilling. So the counter to terror is confidence and faith in systems that work, right? Yeah.
It's up to us and our systems to catch up. It's not going to be the other way around.
Absolutely. Kabir, thank you so much for coming on the Pragati podcast. That has been an absolute pleasure.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.
What did you think of the show? Follow the Pragati podcast at Think Pragati on Twitter and Facebook, and write to me at podcast@thinkpragati.com if you have any questions, comments, or suggestions. The Pragati podcast app is available on the IVM website, the IVM podcast app, or wherever you get your podcasts from. We are there everywhere.
Did I just catch you on your way to work? Or did you end up pulling an all-nighter? Let me guess. You have a packed schedule for the day, the week, and probably the month and the year. That's a lot for your mind to handle, don't you think? This buzzing chaos also brings tons of negative thoughts. Am I right? Try spinning that bottle in a positive direction with me, Chetna, on the Positively Unlimited podcast, every Monday on IVM Podcasts. It's time to change your life one alphabet at a time.
Look, up in the internet. It's a meme. No, it's a cat video. No, it's the Geek Fruit Podcast.
That's right. We interrupt this riveting broadcast to tell you about our show, the Geek Fruit Podcast, where Tejas, Dinkar and I, Jishnu, talk about everything in pop culture, including DC, Marvel, Star Wars, Netflix and everything in between.
You know how your friends hate it when you ramble about some nerdy crap and you just want somebody to listen to you? Well, sorry, there's nothing we can do about that, but come listen to us ramble and it'll almost be like the real thing. Kind of.
Listen to new episodes of the Geek Fruit Podcast every Monday and the Geek Fruit Bulletin every Thursday on iTunes, Google Podcasts, the IVM app, or wherever you listen to podcasts. Happy listening, you nerds.